In chapter 2, we have learned about the basic filter types, and we are going to look at their implementation in the digital domain here. So, but first, let's have a recap on the filter types. So, the first one is low-pass filter. It has in the frequency domain the following characteristic. So, all frequencies which are below a certain cutoff frequency can pass, and all frequencies which are higher are rejected. The high pass filter does the opposite job, so all frequencies which are below a cutoff frequency are rejected, and all frequencies above that cutoff frequencies can pass. Bandpass filter rejects almost all frequencies except one certain band where all frequencies can pass. And its inverse one is the band stop filter. All frequencies can pass except one band which is blocked. So these are the basic filter types. And on the left side here you see the block diagrams which are used. So we have always three of these waves which are in the block diagram symbol. And now have a look at which of these three waves are crossed out. And here you see the principle of how they describe the filter characteristic. So low pass, high pass, or band stop. And so you use the block diagram symbols to give an abstract view on the system and to describe it for other engineers, for example, so that they can get a quick overview of your system which you have designed, or th that you can read the system which someone else has designed. And now we have a look at the implementation of these systems. So in the analog domain, here are some simple circuits which implement the filter characteristic. These are LC circuits. So they consist of an inductance and a capacitor. And so here are some circuits which realize the filters in the analog domain. And what we are going to have a look at now is the implementation in the digital domain. So in the analog domain, electronic circuits and electronic components are used to create hardware circuits, analog circuits, which fulfill the filtering task. And now we are going to learn the components of digital systems to create filters. And there are two types of filters. There are infinite impulse response filters and finite impulse response filters, and the first one is the infinite impulse response filter, or in short the IIR filter. And here you see a block diagram of such an IIR filter. It might look a bit overwhelming, but it isn't. So we have here some components which are used. So the first one is this one. It looks like an amplifier and it does the same job. It takes the input signal here and just multiplies it with this coefficient. Mind that this coefficient can be complex valued, as the input signal can be complex valued too. This just for clarification. So you will probably work with real valued signals, but it's also possible to use complex valued signals. Yeah, so this is just a simple multiplication, nothing more. So very easy. And here you see, you might probably guess what this means. It is just an addition. So you get two or more input signals, and both or all the input signals are added and form the output signal here. Yeah, then this element is interesting. So this is new, and this is a delay element. So how does it work? Imagine that you have this simple system here. This is an analog to digital converter, which converts an analog signal to the digital domain. And this analog to digital converter regularly takes samples out of this input signal, this analog input signal. And yeah, for example, the first sample is a one, and the one is the output of the analog to digital converter, the first output. Yeah, and this is now given to the delay element. But the job of the delay element is to delay the output by one sample period. And now this is the first sample. There were no samples before. So yeah, what is the output? The delay element is preloaded with a certain output, let's say zero. Yeah, nothing special here. It does not let pass the sampled the sample value one here, because it delays it. And what this delay means is when the next sample period is reached. So now the AD converter samples 1.5, and now the output of the delay element is the previous sample. So here it's one. Next period. Now we fall back to, let's say, 0.7. And the output of the delay element is the value which was present before. And here it's 1.5. Yeah, and this goes on and on and on. And the delay element introduces a delay. Yes, see here that the delay element is has this that power minus one. This is the notation which I use, but you will also find other notations like T in capital letters. So the delay element just denotes that the sample is delayed by one sample period. And so this is the depiction here using the connection to the time domain. But if you now transform this delay to the frequency domain, this will become that power minus one. So the derivation can be found in the lecture notes. So please refer to the lecture notes for more information. And I use this notation here to display the connection to the frequency domain. So now we have learned how the delay element works. And with these basic components, we can implement an IIR filter. And so you see the structure here. The IIR filter consists of two parts. The first one is a feedforward network, and the second part is a feedback network. So the feedforward network just takes the input signal and there is a chain of delay elements, and by the way, the number of delay elements defines the filter order. So you know that analog filters can also have an order. So the in the analog domain, the filter order is determined by the number of components which store energy. For example, a capacitor stores energy, an inductance stores energy, and if we go slide back, all those filters here have two storing components, and so their filter order is two in all cases. And the same applies to digital systems. So we have storing elements here, so the delay element has to remember the previous value, so it stores information, it stores data, it stores the signal values. And so like analog domain and analog systems, the order of digital systems is defined by the number of the storing elements, so the filter so the delay elements here. Yeah, so now the input signal is then passed to through this chain of delay elements, and each output of the of each of delay element is tapped. And here the output of the delay element is multiplied by a coefficient, so a white factor, and then all the weighted output is then summed up. And this is then passed in direction to the output, but here the feedback network taps the output signal. And like the feedforward network, the output signal is passed through a chain of through a chain of delay elements, and the delay elements are tapped again, and the output is also summed and summed with the output signal. So here the output of the feedforward network does only depend on the input signal. So this is why this is called feedforward. Input signal forms the output here at this place. But the feedback network does not only depend on the input signal, it also depends on the output signal. So there's a loop here, and yeah, so this is why this part is called feedback. Now the structure here can be used to describe the filter in the time domain. And yeah, you see here the general equation of describing an IIR filter in the time domain. And yeah, you see here the coefficients of the feedforward branch and the coefficients in the feedback branch. Yeah, and this equation can be derived from this structure. So for more information, please have a look into the lecture notes. Now this time domain function can be transferred to the frequency domain, and we get this equation here. So the problem is here that, yeah, see here this minus I and minus L. So this is a consequence of the delay elements here. So for example, for the feedforward branch, each delay element stores a past value, and this is represented here by this N minus I. And same as goes here for the output. The delay elements here in this chain store an output value of the past, represented here by N minus L. And now we can get the transfer function, and now we get this Z minus something, Z minus L that minus I and that minus L here. And now you see the connection to this that minus one here in the delay element. So the more negative the exponent is here, the more the signal is delayed. Or we can also say that the transfer function is the sum of all the feedforward taps divided by 1 plus the sum of all feedback taps. This is the general transfer function of such a design. So how the transfer function is in detail is depends on the filter structure. So you can have more feedforward elements. So we have only three ones here in this example, but you can add more and more, or you can also use less. And same applies to the feedback network. And so the actual design of the filter is done by choosing suitable values for the tap coefficients here, and of course to choose the right number of taps. But this is out of the scope of this lecture. We there are other lectures which concern with the filter design. But here we only accept that there are filters, and you know the basic structure of these filters, but we do not care about the design. However, an important point is the stability of filters. So you know that a system can be stable or unstable. You have learned this in chapter 2. And now we analyze the stability of a digital system like our IIR filters. You can do the stability analysis with a pro zero analysis. So you have a look at the poles and the zeros. The poles are here in the lower part of the this transfer function in the denominator, and now you can analyze all poles and zeros and plot them in a PZ map, a pole zero map. So we now plot all poles and zeros in this complex plane, and we have, for example, a pole here and a zero here, another pole here, zero here, and so on. And now the system is stable if all poles are located within the unit circle. So yeah, if we had a pole which is outside the unit circle, then the system would be unstable. So this is a method to analyze the stability. And why is it important to analyze the stability of IIR filters? So let's have a look at the implementation of the IIR filter. So there's a feedforward network and there's a feedback network. And the feedforward network is not an issue because the output of the feedforward network only depends on the input signals. And but the problem is the feedback network. We can now explain it in the time domain why this feedback network becomes a problem. So what is important here for stability is the impulse response. And the impulse response is the output of the system if a Dirac delta pulse is applied at the input, so here. direct data pulse. You've learned the direct data function in for the analog domain in chapter 2, but here it is zero everywhere, but only one for n equals zero. This is the formal definition of the direct data pulse in the digital domain. So it's a bit different from its variant in the analog domain. And now let's see what happens in the IIR filter if we apply an delta direct pulse onto its input. So imagine you apply it here to the input, and now it is passed through the P4 network. And let's go back. So here through this chain, and when the direct delta pulse reaches this point, then with the next sample it completely disappears and the filter output will be zero again. So the feedforward network is not a problem here with stability. So but the feedback network, because it takes the output and sums it up and up and up, and if we have a stable system, example, a stable system here in yellow, then the first output will be this, maybe the second this, and this, and then it will be at some point will be zero again, or close to zero. What if we have an unstable system? And the values for the feedback network are chosen inappropriately, then the output just sums up and up and so on, and the values get higher and higher and will go to infinity. And this is the characteristic of an unstable system. So the problem here is indeed the feedback network, because it sums up the output. So as a consequence, if you design an IIR filter, you always have to check your design for stability.